ואבן אחים גם יחד.
Brothers to dwell together in unity.
Yes.
You know, and yeah, basically that's beautiful, really beautiful. I heard the song long time and I just love it.
Okay. Ine matovu, ine matovu, la 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 la. Ine matovu, ine matovu, la la la.
My name is Shmuel Tikva Ben Yaakov. I've always known that Igbos are Jews. I've always believed in it, but it never moved me to trying to seek the Jewish ways. When I was growing up, they tell us that the Jews don't believe in Jesus, so they are doomed. So I would think, if they are doomed, I think I am saved now for believing in Jesus, so I don't want to be like them. So he didn't give me the mind to seek the Jewish way. But when I became Jewish, I started seeing the picture in a different light, from a different perspective, and I was glad. Personally, I can't imagine myself practicing Judaism without going to the internet, because I go there to study. The people I've chatted with in the internet, whenever I said I'm Jewish, they've always doubted me, because they don't believe that there are Jews in Nigeria, especially among the citizens, blacks of Africa, or Nigeria in particular. But I know already, being Jewish is in the mind. It's not just being accepted by people, because I know in me there's a Jewish soul. I think that's the most important thing.
Africa, seemingly the birthplace of man, a place where many in the Western world look to for the source of early human existence. But while the West looks towards Africa, Shmuel Tikva Ben Yaakov is looking towards Israel as the birthplace of his ancestors. It's a notion he and so many other young Igbo first heard growing up in Nigeria, an oral history passed down through generations of the Igbo people. But in a land confused by outside forces, those traditions began to bear a different name.
In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
It is only recently, with the arrival of the internet, that things began to change. Young Igbo, like Shmuel, began researching their roots and comparing Igbo traditions with Hebrew traditions. What they found has set them off on a search for identity, ancestry, and community. For many, a long journey of self-discovery, not always welcome in this fervently religious nation. A journey for Shmuel that truly begins at the age of 4 in the Catholic Church, when his name was Samuel Chooks.
I was really serious about what I was doing. I served an Irish Catholic priest, Reverend Father Jeremiah O'Connell. I did my baptism, confirmation, my first Holy Communion ceremony and other things. My parents are not Christians, neither are they Muslims. Like my father, I know he only believes that there is God, and when he wakes up, he prays to God, and that is all. I've never seen my parents go to church. My uncle that raised me is a Catholic. I started still living with him when I was 4. I grew up in his home, so I grew up as a Catholic.
This part of the world, primarily we are born and instituted into Christendom.
Like much of Africa, Nigeria suffers from a complicated sense of identity due to the impact of outside forces. Nigeria's fate came at the hands of the British, who began arriving in the middle of the 1600s. West Africa was a land without international borders. Individual tribes coexisted through times of peace and also conflict. For the British, the coast of West Africa was a place where captured slaves could be easily purchased, and upon arrival began shipping the strongest and most rebellious clear across the Atlantic. The British administration was eventually established, and what followed were schools and churches. The Igbo initially rejected the churches, but attended the schools, thinking they would eventually outsmart their oppressors. Before they realized the schools and the churches were the same, more than half the Igbo were already converted.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Amen!
Missionaries boosted their efforts in the 1980s, this time led by the American Pentecostals.
Due to the efforts of the group called the Pentecostals, they came here and revolutionized Christianity. Nigeria, like the rest of Africa, was sliding into poverty more and more. There was an element which they introduced into Christianity, miracles and so on and so forth. Somebody who dress and learn how to talk very charismatically, take a pulpit and be telling people that I will pray for you, you become rich. I will pray for you, you get a good husband. Everybody knows the condition of Africa. People are hungry, people are sick. People cannot afford to go to hospitals, and there is somebody standing there promising that if he prays, that people will be well, that if he prays, people will be rich. Igbos are jumping in too to partake of those miracles.
The white man is very clever. He came quietly and peaceably with his religion. We were amused at his foolishness and allowed him to stay. Now he has won our brothers, and our clan can no longer act like one. He has put a knife on the things that held us together, and we have fallen apart. Chinua Achebe, things fall apart.
Reborn Kol Amasim Adon Ol Barokata Adona Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asha Yezah.
I'm the one heading the women of the community, and they call me Mother General.
Mother General.
Yes.
Mude anile faneka adona elo.
I do lead prayer from the first to the last I can. When my husband is not in, I will lead. People will feel very comfortable seeing me leading. Very, very comfortable seeing me leading. They will say, Mommy, we love the way you pray. So they are not annoyed.
Adonai Eka.
Tensions run high in Nigeria, and there's no subject that elicits more emotion than religion. In this fervently religious nation, where there's not an atheist or agnostic in sight, the country's 130 million divides roughly equally among Muslims and Christians. Religion is everywhere in Nigeria, particularly Christianity.
The Bible said that Jesus saw somebody.
The bus in Nigeria doesn't depart without a blessing, and religious debate permeates street corner conversation throughout the country.
And God refused to bless him. God refused to bless him until he separated with the last
person. To embrace Judaism is to denounce all of this, and to also face hostility where international terrorist groups are now on the rise. For Shimuel and other Igbo with strong beliefs in an Igbo Jewish origin, the decision to embrace Judaism must come with a large amount of certainty.
I know from birth I'm a Jew. Only I know that my forefather missed the way. They missed the way by coming down to Nigeria and decided to behave like Nigerians. We are not Nigerians, I'm sure of that.
I grew up alongside every other Igbo youth. We kept on hearing that Igbo people came from Israel.
There was a story my mom told me at the age of 6 years. I never forget. He said, the Igbos are Jews.
As a child, my father taught us, we do not eat these fishes without scales. How did he know that? We don't eat pigs. How did he know that? Even the way we kill our animals, which is killed in a kosher way.
The ritual cleansing, using of birds, animal sacrifice, the slaughter.
Other laws like resting day in the Igbo land will have resting days. Our marriage rites, our birth.
People will generally mention that Igbo people came from Israel. Talk about circumcision on the 8th day, which is universal among the Igbos.
In Igbo land, even before the coming of Christianity, who brought the Bible? In the Bible, we saw circumcision on the 8th day. The Igbos have been circumcising their children on the 8th day. It's an Igbo culture. And secondly, the Nida law, there's this concept in Igbo land that a woman in her menstruation shouldn't cook for her husband, shouldn't sleep with her husband. There's what we call mbuke, a room in the backyard where a woman in her menstruation is sent to stay, and she doesn't come close to the husband until after her menstrual flow.
And the Igbo people, by nature and tradition, they believe in the worship of one God, and they don't believe in personality worship.
The Igbo man had one supreme God called Chukwu, who deserves worship alone.
And you have Chukwuka, God is greatest. Chukwu, my God knows it all. Chukwu Yem, God gave me. These are names that we were bearing before the advent of Christianity.
There are a lot of Igbo words that sounds quite similar to that of Hebrew.
Igbo is getting from the word Ibrim.
Abraham was the Ibri. It was specifically referred to in the Bible as Abraham the Hebrew. And if we are to translate Hebrew to Hebrew language, we'll have Ibri. But I believe that the word Igbo or Igbo is a corruption of Ibri or Ivri.
In Hebrew, we have kol, kof, waw, lamed. And kol in Hebrew means voice. And in Igbo, the kof was removed, substituted with vowel letter O to be olu, meaning voice. Another Hebrew word, mezuzah, a prayer box you put on the front of your door. And in Igbo, we have mezuzah, meaning put the door in order. Hebrew, ketan, little or small. And Igbo, we have nkenta, meaning little or small. If these people are not descendants of Israel, how come their language rhymes with that of Eretz Israel?
Abe Abra Adonai Todaraba Abi Haharo Adonai Todaraba Hashem Todaraba O Barukata Shenata Tura Adonai Todaraba
Hashem Todaraba
Barukata Shenata Tura Adonai Todaraba Hashem Todaraba O Barukata.
I lost interest in the Catholic Church because I remember sometimes when we ask questions, they tell us it's a mystery. So I was always asking certain questions, like sometimes I even want to say, who created God? How did it happen that Mary became pregnant without having an intercourse with a man? They kept on telling me, it's a mystery, it's a mystery, it's a mystery. So at a point, I got fed up and I was looking up to my father as a role model, that I think what my father is doing is the right thing, so I should be like my father. Called me once to tell me that this Jesus I always talk about wasn't even a Christian, that he was a Jew and practiced Judaism. I only knew that Jews were the children of Israel, and then the Jews were the people who killed Jesus Christ.
It was misconceptions about Judaism like this that prevented Shmuel from exploring Judaism further. In a land with few Jewish resources, it's a common stumbling block for many Igbo. But then Shmuel met someone who challenged that idea and many other of his beliefs.
After my higher education, I went to do the National Youth Service Corps, which is compulsory for graduates. So at that time, I became friends with Benjamin. When I discovered he was Jewish, I was disappointed. I started calling him names like occultist and things like that. But you know, as time went on, I started seeing that he was somehow right in what he was doing, because sometimes we come to argue, we would be like 6 to 7 Christians against him alone, and we spoke from church doctrines and other things, but he was speaking from the Bible, trying to let us understand why the laws of God are not obsolete, why we need to respect the Shabbat, respect Kashrut and other things. Even though I would argue with him and I wouldn't want to accept his views, but when I went into my room, I always thought of what transpired during the day, and somehow I would say, this guy is right here, he's right here. So after some time I met him, I said, Ben, I would like to observe the Shabbat with him. And he was pleased and said, okay. And we cooked together, bought wine, and arranged for the Shabbat, and that was how I started.
Shmuel continued observing the weekly Jewish Sabbath, both with Benjamin and on his own. He researched what he could about Judaism and joined his friend where he worshipped. What simplified the ease of transitioning into this Judaism was that it was somewhat familiar to Shmuel. Prayers were made in the name of Jesus, and many of the evangelical elements of Christianity were blended into Judaism, making it palatable to once Christians. This mixing of Judaism and Christianity remains quite popular in Nigeria, and the Messianic or Sabbatarian movements attract large numbers of people and large amounts of funds. But for Shmuel, this didn't feel right. It was a wrong turn, but one quite common on the Nigerian road to Judaism. Soon after, Shmuel journeyed to Nigeria's capital, Abuja, in search of a job. It was while visiting the neighborhood of a friend that he made a startling discovery about his new religion.
I saw Elder Habakkuk. I saw him, you know, pass by. And I looked at him and something told me, this man is a Jew. But I didn't say anything to him. I didn't even greet him. I passed. But somehow my mind kept on bothering me that I should have greeted the man. I should have said shalom. That how could I meet a fellow Jew and refused to even say hi. So I told my friend, I asked him if he knew anywhere he can find a Jewish or even a Sabbath church, something that has to do with Sabbatarianism. And he said, okay, that he knows one place, but it won't be easy for him to locate the place. It was more than 1 hour. I saw an Israeli flag flying there, so I knew it was the place. Then I went in and I met El Habakkuk, introduced myself to him, and he told me, okay, you are welcome. We practice Judaism here.
This is the name of our kerosene, Tikvat Israel. 6 years ago. We started from Messianic before we grew up to practicing Judaism. This is our temporary synagogue. You can see the alphabet, the Eliyahu seats. This is my beloved wife. Yes, my beautiful wife, my beautiful queen. My children are 6 in number. One of the commandments of the Almighty Father, he said, we should build the house of God through the Feast of Sukkot. They made of the palm tree leaf. As you can see here, this is the Magan of David. The stones represent the 12 tribes of Israel. If you can count it, it's 12 in number. These 3 tablet stones under, it represents to me the laws of Hashem, the statutes of Hashem, and the ordinance of Hashem. When the Almighty Father removed each of these tablets, that means the world is falling. This is roots, different types of roots. If I want to prepare any medicine for fever, stomach problems, I use it. You can see this bottle, although it's dark, it's a special house prepared here for poison, but it's kosher. Yes. It's a little bit bitter. A little bit bitter. Yes. Shofar, the one we can have here in Africa, in Nigeria.
About my family,
you say that we are rich.
That some of us are saying we are willing, some also say we wish to, you know, wish to keep people and use the blood for medicine.
I used to be very scared of him because of the religion. I don't know the kind of religion. My first time of seeing such religion.
We used to sing maybe midnight. So they say, these people, they are practicing cult. They are afraid of me. They are looking at me, maybe I will act dangerously to them. There is no way. I used to make friends with them, helping them, doing everything. If they call me meeting, I will go, except the meeting that fall on Saturday. But Sunday and other days, they invite me, I will go. Some of them attempt of killing me. But Hashem Baruch Hu is on my side. When I put them again, I put on that Hebrew writing there. I don't want to translate it in English. If you want to know the meaning, then you come to the synagogue and ask. Yes. Yes. I set up that magen. They say, this is the sign of the Jews.
I found out that it was the religion of the Israelites. And even till today, it's been practiced. I bought some films that has to do with Judaism and other things like that. So I am now okay. And I love all of them.
I know before any Jew will survive, he must suffer. This is our destiny. And I think that is the reason why maybe they give me the chairman of this area, because they have tried to get me down, but they cannot succeed.
Life in Nigeria is chaotic. Cars constantly break down, hostage takings in the Delta, and with high unemployment and few standards of safety, one sees all sorts of unusual sights. Gathering at synagogue on Shabbat comes as a welcome relief to many, and as Jewish tradition dictates, the day of rest begins with a dip in the mikvah, the ritual bath. In Nigeria, that is the river.
As we're getting close to the Shabbat, I'm going to wash up. I'll take my bath with soap and clean up, and I dip myself in the water and come out.
Ma.
once it is performed, you are assumed ritually clean, and you are therefore free to participate properly in the Shabbat.
Getting ready for Shabbat also means the preparation and cooking of all the weekend meals for everyone gathered.
Jewish people in Nigeria, they eat kosher food. We don't compromise. Despite we have, we don't have, we eat kosher things.
I refuse eating in a restaurant. When at times some friend will call me, come and eat another thing, I tell them that, no, I'm not going to eat. What is the problem? I said, because of my faith.
We don't even want unkosher things to be around us.
Personally, I don't eat meat. There's a specialized process, which is the shekita process of slaughtering it. So if it is not slaughtered in that form, I don't eat it. So I don't eat meat from the market, grass cutters. They are a kind of rodent. They are like rats, but they are larger and they live in the wild. And so it's a very popular meat in Africa, especially in the Igbo land. We call it inchi. And it is believed that when you have a guest and you give him grass cutter, you've really honored your guest. But it's not kosher, so I stopped eating it. When we still eat our African food, but we make it kosher.
Like fish, they eat scaly fish.
It's rice. Rice is a staple food in Nigeria. It's a very common food.
Mostly in this part of the world, we eat carbohydrates. We have a lot of carbohydrates. We can mix anything in the carbohydrates to eat.
We have cassava. A kind of food we make from cassava, we pound it like the pounded yam. So we call it apu. So it's very popular. Then from cassava is processed to gari. We boil water, pour the gari, then it's baked, and we use it to eat soup.
We prepare soup, that is vegetables. Then you put fish, then you put oil. Then as you don't eat salt, but you use salt to wash the leaves to make it kosher, then at times we can season it with a little maggi to make it tasteful. And that white soup, they use pounded yam to eat it. I told them since yesterday, they should prepare flour for challah. Now they have come with it. I'm going to prepare it.
Okay, I'm here. The ingredient is oil, salt, flour, yeast, and baking powder. Then you see the loaf of the bread will come out. I will bake it. And then you will eat it.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher kidesh lanu b'mitzvotav v'ziwanu lehalik nel shel Shabbat, so that we are saved. Amen. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Shmuel returned to the synagogue of Habakkuk a few days later for the Friday evening Shabbat service. It was there that he confronted the biggest challenge in his new belief, something that almost every Igbo struggles with as they learn what it means to be a Jew.
When I went for the Shabbat, they prayed, and then they studied from the Bible. They didn't study from the New Testament. They never mentioned Jesus or Yeshua, and I wasn't comfortable with it. So after everything, I asked the question. I said, please, that I'm surprised your prayers and your teachings, you didn't end the prayers in the name of Jesus or Yeshua, and you didn't even mention him. So I think your practice is different from what I practice. So they asked me, who is Jesus or Yeshua? I said, Jesus is our Lord and Savior. They started laughing at me. I was embarrassed. They asked me, do I think Jesus is the Savior? I said, yes. So they said, okay, how do I prove it? I said, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through me. And somebody asked me, then what did God say? Have I ever thought of what God said? That God never said, Jesus is my son. I said, okay, but when he was baptized,
a voice was heard, and they asked me, whose voice? Did God ever say it is his voice? And the thing sank deep into me. Some other quotations they gave me from the Old Testament, from Isaiah, where God said, I am the only God. There was no God before me, and there can't be any God after me. And then, I am the only Savior. And then, what about the prophecy of a virgin giving birth to a child, and we shall call him Emmanuel, and other things? And it proved to me that it wasn't even talking about Jesus. So it was talking about the days of King Ahaz. So what my father was telling me started ringing in my brain about Jesus. He was Jewish and he wasn't even a Christian. My father told me that he believes that Christianity was started by Paul. If not the Romans, then we cannot connect him to Jesus. Believe me, there and then I denounced Jesus and Yeshua. I knelt down, I prayed to God, I said, Father, you made me to meet Elder Habakkuk, and I believe you have a hand in dragging me to this place. I won't pray in the name of Jesus or Yeshua anymore until you prove to me physically that this is Jesus. For now, I'm done with Jesus, and it ended there. And I'm happy I did.
While the link between the Igbo and Judaism are obvious to many Igbo, those practicing Judaism are small in number. Rough estimates figure that is less than 3,000 who have embraced the faith, while the vast majority of Igbo remain active Christians. But as one of the three largest groups of Nigeria, the Igbo number approximately 25 million. And as the movement towards Judaism continues to grow, it has the potential to create a Jewish community of enormous size. So who exactly are the Igbo? If the name is slightly familiar, it is because this group of people came to world attention less than 40 years ago, when the Igbo were pitted in a bloody war against their very own government and suffered tremendous loss. It was 1964, and Nigeria had only recently won its independence from British colonial rule. The economic situation was bleak, and ethnic tensions were high. A military coup escalated the situation. Common thought was that Igbo were responsible and were attempting to dominate the country.
They started massacring Igbos wherever Igbos were to be found outside Igbo land.
Old men, children, women, young men were massacred. Even pregnant women, they were cut open. The number of Igbos that died was so much. It was a very, very sad moment for the Igbos.
In the end, 30,000 Igbo had been killed, and 1 million had fled to the southeast. It was there that the Igbo began to organize, and quickly came to realize they were no longer safe in Nigeria. They would need to form their own independent Igbo nation, and thus bore Biafra. The act ignited the country into a civil war, pitting the Nigerian government against the Igbo people.
Trouble among the emerging nations as buses line up to carry civilian volunteers to Nigerian army recruiting centers. Some 10,000 citizens answered their government's call to arms. Nigeria's rebel eastern state, the Republic of Biafra, declared its independence, setting off an unofficial war. Even women leave their homes and jobs to volunteer for military service. Nigeria is attempting to regain the breakaway state, and declared that if necessary, Biafra will be crushed by force.
And the Igbo people of Biafra tried to defend her territorial integrity and her people.
Despite the efforts of the Igbo resistance, the Igbo suffered terribly and lost more and more control of the land. It was ultimately the economic blockade that caused the most harm, cutting off all resources to food. Starvation was rampant, and images of children with distended stomachs from lack of protein became familiar to the world. Recently declassified White House documents suggest an ambivalent Nixon administration. Then National Security Advisor Henry Kissinger suggests that starvation was a brilliant public relations move. He also refers to the Igbo as the wandering Jews of West Africa, gifted, aggressive, westernized, an analogy that historically perhaps helped birth or reinforce a movement. In January of 1970, after a 2.5-year battle, the dream of an independent Igbo state came to an end, and with it, the lives of 1 million Igbo, dead from either fighting or starvation. In today's Nigeria, the memory of Biafra is still fresh in the minds of many Igbo. The government only recently transitioned to civilian rule, and the news out of Nigeria still tends to be of government corruption and misuse of funds. Much of this stems from the country's abundance of natural oil, the envy of many a nation, including the United States. But despite this wealth, Africa's most populous nation often seems more saddled by a reputation of terrorism, internet scams, megacities, militant unrest, and high poverty. The Igbo face all of these obstacles together, still bonded from the events of Biafra and centuries of common tradition. It is perhaps one of the reasons why the Igbo care so deeply about their origin, and why a certain group of Igbo, both Jewish and Christian, believe in a forefather named Eri.
According to the history, that Eri is the forefather, the ancestor that we had. He came with his brothers down to the east and established his first home.
In exploring a Jewish connection, many Igbo also point out that a figure named Eri is frequently mentioned in the Old Testament. To determine if the Igbo ancestor could be the same Eri of biblical times, we can gain a few facts from the Old Testament. Jacob had 12 sons. His 7th son was named God. God himself had 7 sons, the 5th by the name of Eri. Eri is only mentioned in one other place in the Bible, in Numbers, revealing that Eri had himself multiplied and that God and his descendants now numbered over 40,000. Jacob's 12 sons and their vast number of descendants became the 12 tribes of Israel. 10 of these tribes, including that of God, made home in Samaria, today the northern part of present-day Israel. In the year 722 BCE, the tribes were attacked by Assyria and quickly conquered. Sent into exile, they scattered throughout the land, and it is here that we lose track of the 10 lost tribes, including God, Eri, and their families. Could Eri and his descendants have ended up in Western Africa? In Nigeria, the belief is yes, and there are many theories on just how they got there.
Where Israel is not far away from Nigeria, very close to Nigeria. They enter Ethiopia, enter Cameroon, and Cameroon with our place.
Through Asia, and how they migrated through Sudan to Africa.
When the Jerusalem was destroyed and we were dispersed, we set up stayed in Egypt, then Ethiopia. The travel continued until we find ourselves scattered all over the place.
It was a mixed bag of Israelites that migrated down here. They moved, majority, moved from North Africa, Morocco, passed through Mali, northern Nigeria, entire length of Nigeria, then Igbo land. In not very, very ancient times, the traffic between Africa south of the Sahara and north of the Sahara was quite immense. The Sahara Desert was not a barrier. There was serious traffic. We are seeing evidence that Jewish people participated in the foundations of some of the empires that existed in sub-Saharan Africa. We have Judah Pasha. I don't think that anybody but a Jew could have answered the name Judah Pasha. He led Morocco's armies against the Songhai Empire. So it's more likely for Jews to be participating in the traffic, in the trade.
The color of our ancestors who migrated is not what I can tell.
Do you think they were white? They were black. They were black. Abraham was black. Even Yaakov was not a white man. I think you get my point.
I don't want to sound racist. If I say Abraham is black, then I'll be saying his white descendants are not his descendants. And if I say he is white, then I may be saying
he cannot have black descendants. So I think it has to do with environmental factors.
When he visits Aguilera, Nri, there's many evidence to show that is where the first our ancestors migrated to.
For that, one has to travel deep into Igbo land to the ancient kingdom of Aguilera.
The palace of Eri has stayed over 1,000 plus.
It's a small house they built for a man. That's what they mean, Aguilera.
There is buried ground of Eri in Aguilera.
And even when they came down here, they constructed a monument, Yata Aguilera, called Obugat.
The person that came is the descendant of Eri. It could be Eri, it could be the descendant of Eri. But all I know is that the lineage of Eri came down to Nigeria.
The 10 lost tribes of Israel are scattered all over the world, and they believe some of them will be in Africa, Western Africa.
Remember that Almighty said that he will drive his children all over the world. He did not specify a particular place. He said he will scatter them. Somebody who believes that prophecy is true should also know that Africa is part of the world. It's also existing in the world, which Almighty said that he will scatter them all over.
Scientist, I'm skeptical by nature, and having worked in Nigeria for so many years, I'm very well aware of the inauthentic as well as the authentic things that come out of that amazing country.
There's a great Yiddish expression, "Gesund Tachet," meaning God love them and I wish them well.
Everybody knows about the financial scams, the email scams, you've won the lottery, just that kind of stuff.
There's the historical inquiry. Are there, is there a substance to their claims of being part of the lost tribes? I think that whole thing is mythic.
I was very skeptical. And I arrived in that mode, friendly and respectful.
You had this missionizing of places like Africa and Asia. The missionaries came in, they would tell Bible stories. They were not really good anthropologists. They would ask really leading questions, and they would get answers that responded to leading questions. In the Talmud, there is some mention of the Ten Lost Tribes, but you've got a gap of hundreds of years before there's any attempt at trying to identify them. What I'm saying is that the Ten Lost Tribes seems to be a myth.
It was within, 10 minutes of davening in the synagogue where they knew how to daven. They knew the Hebrew. Of course, there were differences in Jewish literacy and mastery of Hebrew. But the prayer leaders, they didn't need me. And I didn't know that before I came. Do they know Hanukkah? But it's the real deal. And I felt it. And I've been processing that experience ever since in terms of the meaning of Judaism, Jewish identity, who has the right to call himself or herself Jewish, who has the right to exclude others from calling themselves Jewish. It was humbling, Jeff. It was really humbling.
As opposed to seeing Africa as this isolated place, a more accurate understanding of Africa is that it has been an area of interaction for many, many, many years, for millennia, and populations have been moving back and forth, both emanating out of Africa and into Africa. There were Jewish communities in the Sahara and in the Sahel. Of that, there's no question. Some of the speculation is that some of these communities migrate from as far north as Iberia and are seeking to escape difficulties there, and they move into the Saharan area, they move into the Sahel. It's difficult for me to imagine how they would get from there all the way into southeastern Nigeria. I mean, it's possible. No, it's possible.
Another source for exploration is the journal of an ex-slave whose story became an international bestseller. Olado Equiano was the first African to publish in English during the 18th century. In his narrative, he paints a picture of a serene life in West Africa, and in describing his Igbo childhood, makes several comparisons to the Jewish people.
The well-known Olado Equiano, Gustavus Vassa, whose Igbo identity has been challenged, but I think by and large, he's a pretty reliable person. Equiano made references to Jews, I think because it was the closest comparison for Christians that he could come up with. And when he's talking about Jews, he's talking about both biblical Jews, as any Christian in those days would know from the Old Testament, but also perhaps for contemporary Jews, which are probably not as well known to his audience.
More contemporary scientific research has found a genetic link amongst the Lemba of South Africa and Zimbabwe with Israeli men who descend from the Kohanim. That priestly Jewish line descends through male lineage, therefore making it an ideal source for the Y chromosome DNA test. But not all are in favor of DNA tests for the Igbo.
There's no way that we're ever going to be able to determine that the Igbos actually are DNA Jews. And I don't think we should be too caught up on that, because what's the implication? Let's say we did DNA tests, like we've done for the Lemba in southern Africa. And let's say it comes out negative. So then we should exclude from the Jewish universe, or the potential Jewish universe, all these people who have been living their lives as Jews on the basis that it was a false myth of having descended from?
Many of the Jews of Nigeria also reject the idea of DNA testing, questioning the need to prove their faith when Western Jews aren't required to do the same. On the flip side, DNA testing has helped many African Americans discover their own Igbo roots. Actor Forrest Whitaker and Bishop T.D. Jakes have discovered genetic links. So a Jewish Igbo connection could begin to raise questions for many African Americans.
Many African Americans actually do not know that they have Igbo heritage. The chances of their being Igbo is much, much higher than their chances of coming from Ghana or from Western Nigeria.
If you're from the right county in Virginia, you probably have a 60% chance of having Igbo ancestry. I would say probably the only country in the Americas that would have a higher Igbo rate would be possibly Jamaica.
The Igbo are a very, very big part of the African-American, as far as the United States go, African-American history.
Igbo culture and tradition is in North America and in a lot of African-American families, and definitely in Gullah Geechee families, but people don't know that it's Igbo. So it's here, and it's sort of just under the surface, where you just got to pull at that fabric just a little bit and then get a real peek at it.
Oh, 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 freedom. Oh, oh, freedom. Oh, oh, freedom. Oh, Bowie. And before we be your slave, we gwine be buried, we grave, and gwine home till we go and be free.
The Gullah and Geechee people have made home on the islands off of South Carolina and Georgia since the days of enslavement. For generations, they have remained somewhat of a mystery to outsiders. They speak their own language and have largely lived an isolated life on the same family properties, handed down generation through generation. It is perhaps this isolation that maintained their unique similarities to African tradition.
The Gullah Geechee people are an amalgamation of various West African ethnic groups, including some from Nigeria. The Yoruba and the Igbos are part of our ancestry from West Africa. So if you were to look at a map of Africa from the Senegambia down to Angola, we had ancestors come from almost every ethnic group within that course of peoples. But we found over time that with the Igbos, we have a lot of cultural traditions still in common even today.
In the 1930s, the Federal Writers Project began an ambitious endeavor to record the stories of ex-slaves living on these islands. More than 2,000 interviews were conducted, painting a picture of plantation life as seen through the eyes of young men and women now nearing the end of their lives.
We'll be done. Trouble.
Many shared stories of their African-born grandmothers and grandfathers. Overall, the ethnic group most frequently mentioned was the Igbo.
Soon we'll be done.
Basically, the Igbo trade is the 18th century and it's English. And the English 18th century trade is well documented. Most of the ships that went there, we know their names and that kind of thing. We know what their itineraries were and we know where they sent people.
Ship records, plantation schedules, and letters detailing slave transactions give further proof to an Igbo presence in America.
About 50,000 Igbo left Africa to go to the United States. It makes the Igbo among the larger of the groups that came.
Igbo were regarded as smart and skilled, but also tenacious and rebellious, with an undying quest to return home.
The Igbo had a very bad reputation, so many planters didn't want to buy Igbo slaves.
That reputation can be easily seen in newspapers dating back to the era. Slave owners placed advertisements offering rewards for recapture of their runaway slaves. Detailed descriptions often mention birth origin, and one can see the anglicized spelling of Igbo mentioned time and again.
The majority of those who ran away were of Igbo origin, including Igbo women. There was also the claim that the tendency of Igbos to kill themselves rather than stay in slavery, more than any other ethnic group, the Igbo were seen as really a bad investment.
That defiant Igbo spirit is still alive 200 years later on St. Simon's Island, a town in southeast Georgia where locals still refer to one area as Igbo Landing.
Igbo Land is a sacred place to the Igbos and to the Geechee and the Gullah people because it was there that 13 Nigerians jumped into the ocean as opposed to coming into chattel slavery.
Igbo Landing sits on a bluff of Dunbar Creek in the now upscale neighborhoods of St. Simon's Island. But this vacation destination was once home to a handful of plantations whose remains still scatter this island. 90 miles south of Savannah, St. Simon's was a remote island with no connection to the mainland. At its height, it was picturesque. Lined with oak trees and once 96 varieties of roses, sailors said they could smell St. Simon's a dozen miles from shore. But it was also a vast center of Sea Island cotton production, enriching a dozen white families at the expense of a community of thousands of slaves. Today, with some searching, one can find the remains of slave cabins and the boarded-up schoolhouse, built in a post-slavery segregated South. Despite the population shift, most residents seem very aware of the story of Igbo Landing and the monumental event that took place in these waters.
This is the site of the Igbo Landing. I think they brought the ships right up here full moon, high tide, dead of night.
Old people start telling stories about it, that, you know, we had kindred that died there.
And Dunbar Creek's really a beautiful neighborhood. Folks don't do much entertaining after dark, though. Their friends won't come.
Tales like they go out fishing and the boat starts spinning around, or the oars just leap off the boat. When I was a girl coming up, I was told that it was fiction. And then later, about 1980, I learned that maybe it wasn't fiction, that it was possibly a truth. But of course, I didn't know how at that time.
The story of Ibo Landing has long been mythologized, but historian Hal Sieber spent several years in St. Simons and uncovered a letter from 1803 that proves the actual event. Slave dealer William Maine writes to Pierce Butler, a wealthy plantation owner on St. Simons Island. Maine describes the events aboard the York, a smuggled ship filled with 75 Igbo and Angolan slaves, a ship that was winding its way through Dunbar Creek. Maine describes what happens next as a result of mismanagement by the captain, Patterson. The Negroes rose by being confined in a small vessel. Patterson was frightened, and in swimming ashore, he with two sailors were drowned. The Negroes took to the marsh.
And the way it was passed down to us is that there was a woman chained in the group. And when she made one sound, the entire group turned around together and walked back to the motherland.
They had a Nigerian chief, and the chief was not going into slavery, and the men that were with him followed the chief.
Some of the Igbos now sort of be armed and armed, they sort of be now be locked up going into the water.
It was a revolt, and that in this revolt that they did not want to be here.
They looked around, they decided they'd rather die than live as slaves on this strange looking island. They began chanting to an African water spirit. Waters brought us, waters take us away. Waters brought us, waters take us away. Take us away, take us away, take us away.
We may never know the true intentions of those Igbo on that winter day in 1803, but their quest for freedom carries on through story and song.
Before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. Today, of course, when we sing that song, it's oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. And before I be a slave, I gwine be buried my grave and gwine home. The power of survival that came through in that song and why it's carried us from the time of chattel enslavement, from Igbo landing, all the way through the Civil War, through Reconstruction, through Jim Crow, right through the Civil Rights era, where people still locked arms, walking and singing that song, left churches singing that song, went into the street singing that song, came back into the praise house singing that song, and truly have stood for that self-determination that our Igbo ancestors left in our DNA.
No segregation over me, over me. And before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free and be no more dogs.
If the spirit of captive Igbo in the Americas is any indication of an Igbo resilience, perhaps it is something that Shmuel drew upon as he began to embrace a Jewish life further and shared the news with his family.
After the second Shabbat in the synagogue, El Habakkuk told me that he it's so funny, that he loves me and wants me to be around. I should move my things to the synagogue compound, stay with him.
He's like my son. I trust him. I have a rule and regulation.
One rule, I remember, he will tell you.
If you can obey them, you stay with me, no problem.
If you want to break the Shabbat, you leave on Friday. Don't even stay.
I don't need anybody to hear and defy Shabbat for me.
I accepted and moved to the synagogue compound.
Embraced with the love of Habakkuk's family and a community of Jews, Shmuel flourishes. He studies whatever materials he can lay his hands on and is amazed at how many Jewish traditions mirror those of the Igbo. Shmuel's search has led him home. But while hoping getting closer to home might have brought him closer to his family, Shmuel faces a whole new obstacle in his journey.
My father is an enlightened man. I still say it, he was the first person to tell me about Judaism. But my mother was deceived by her friends that I have joined an occultic society, that we keep kosher because we drink human blood. So when we eat those food we avoid, it mixes up with human blood and reacts in us and we die. It kills us. So my mother had that concept that, oh, my son is lost. So she came to warn me and she was telling me that now if I hadn't gotten deep into it, that I can still come out. My father tried to convince her that Judaism is a pure religion, but she wouldn't listen. You know, she burst into tears.
Shmuel's experience is not uncommon. Those returning to Judaism face opposition from all sides.
My mother started saying that, this my son strongly believes in this. She's never seen me like this before. So when she started, what is there that makes you to believe so strongly like this? I said, Mom, a man is being born on earth. And the moment you are outside your mother's womb, you choose your own ways to follow.
What does your wife think about Judaism?
Not acceptable to her. Not acceptable to her. Her idea is that we got married in Christianity, that we must remain there. And while we are in Christianity, we are at a certain height of popularity. I have three kids. Three beautiful kids. They pray with me when I'm praying. They join me in prayers. But to avoid conflict, I go alone to the synagogue and I don't want us to have fight because of the faith. No.
My mother is not happy with me. My sisters are not happy with me. They will say, it's a pity. My father will say, come, let's pray. I will tell him, no, Dad, I cannot pray with you. He will go mad. And everybody will be like, ooh, this boy is mad. I am still living in isolation in my family. I am like an outcast among them.
The isolation caused by family rejection makes communities like Habakkuk's not only a place of worship, but one of support. His synagogue in Abuja is just one of several synagogues scattered throughout the country. In oil-abundant Port Harcourt, members gather at a large synagogue amongst a crowded neighborhood.
Elohim Sivaon, Elohim Mekadeskem, Elohim Shalom to the Rabbah Adonai. Hey, 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 Asher, hey, hey, to the Rabbah Adonai. Hey, 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 Asher, hey, 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 to the Rabbah Adonai. Hey, 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 Asher, hey, hey, to the Rabbah Adonai.
While tucked into the palm tree forest outside Oweri, Igbo from the surrounding areas of the original Igbo land join together. From Wari to Lagos Back to Abuja, where there are four synagogues in the city, Judaism is re-emerging. Over at the Gihon Synagogue in Abuja, there was once no doors, no windows, and just a dirt floor. But Judaism is alive and well and full of spirit.
Hosea Shalom!
Hallelujah!
Hosea Shalom!
Hallelujah!
Hosea Shalom!
Singing and songs play a very important role in our synagogue. Hashem will open the eyes of individual to extract them from the Siddur. So when such a person come up with the songs, he will now teach the whole congregation. And you see, we begin to sing.
One person who exemplifies that ability is Kohen.
I lead prayers, I sing, and I teach. Initially, there was no vast knowledge of Hebrew here. Even though they have the Hebrew alphabet, I have to teach. When I came into the religion, I discovered to my greatest surprise that the Jews pray in Hebrew. I had the urge to pray like them. I was looking for people that will coach me in Hebrew. I had correspondent, Vaad Leshon Ivrit, in Jerusalem. They were sending me materials. I started Aleph Bet. From Aleph Bet, they were sending other books. They wanted to know why. I explained myself. I love the religion of the Jews, and I want to associate myself with them. At that time, I wasn't bold enough to tell them I'm Jewish. Later on, I ran out of cash and the material ceased.
I know Kohim from Suleja, so I now told him that I need his assistance to come and help my synagogue and at the same time to teach us Hebrew.
So I came here. That is how we started. These boys you see around us are all students of Hebrew. Today they can not only read, they write and they understand Hebrew. We are not yet perfect. We look forward to the day we will be perfect by having our conversations fully. Hours of conversation all in Hebrew. That is the day we will term ourselves perfect people.
Hallelujah.
Soon after arriving at Habakkuk's synagogue, Kohen was confronted with another equally important role for him in Judaism. He would not have suspected it would be at a Christian school that rents a building on Habakkuk's property.
I felt there is a missing gap I have to fill there. I mean, the building where they are staying belongs directly to a person who is practicing Judaism. That is Elder Habakkuk. Most of our children are schooling there. So automatically, the need arises for somebody like me to be there so that at least our children will feel a sense of belonging.
Times two, times what?
Five. When he came, he was the only Jewish man to me. But having an encounter with the owner of this place, with the difference in him compared to others, I really want to know what religion is this, that people are straightforward.
The school authorities themselves are quite tremendous. They are wonderful people. Even though the proprietress of the school is a Christian, we don't have any problem with each other. There are some schools you will go, you will not be allowed to put your cap. But They don't argue over those things.
He teaches English, math, even religion. We allow him.
I never objected to teach their religion. I teach them the Bible. I tell them Jesus was a good man, not a savior. And I try to let them understand that the Bible they have today originated from Jewish Torah. So isn't that great?
But there was a time I just came to the class and was giving them, you know, a story about David. And the way he was explaining it, it's just that I was too shy to sit down and say, let me listen to what he was saying, because it's like my own understanding is different from what I had in.
We make use of every opportunity we have, because knowledge is power.
Whether it's Shabbat or Jewish holidays like Sukkot and Passover, each is greeted by Igbo gathering together from all corners. And of course, joining in triumphant song. As Shmuel continued with his studies, he mastered the recitation of one of the holiest of Jewish holiday prayers. Said once a year on the Jewish Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, the Kol Nidre has historically brought people to tears.
As I was leading the service, I got to a point where we had to read what happened to the rabbis, how they were killed for the sake of Torah, how they were, some of them were burnt. It's a painful story. Even though I wasn't there, I imagined myself being there, and I thought of myself being a rabbi. I couldn't control my emotions. I started crying, and people started, you know, holding me to say it's okay. And some people also shed tears as I was crying. I knew it was a moment of sober reflection, but I didn't know it was traditional for people to cry. I felt it.
That spiritual connection also seems to foster a passion for contemporary Jewish concerns, everything from intermarriage to Israel to the Holocaust.
The Holocaust is something that touches the mind of every Igbo man. What has happened to them is supposed to be an eye-opener to us. So if we don't study, we may be facing the same situations they faced.
Are your children any of them married?
No.
No.
Mm-hmm.
You hope they choose a Jewish husband or wife?
This is a good question you are asking me, because you do ask that question. My first daughter is of marriage age. When we embraced Judaism, I told her, if you don't bring a Jewish man, don't call me in your marriage, I'm not coming. So she used to be scared.
We watch on the telly, when it comes to this CNN or foreign news, when they show us of what is happening in Israel, and I shed tears when I see all these things.
Each time we hear that there's a suicide bombing in Israel, you see Igbos lamenting, crying.
Each year, thousands of Christian Nigerians pilgrimage to Israel through government-funded programs. There's no equivalent for the Jews of Nigeria.
So many, many, many persons will want to go to Jerusalem. So if it is possible, many people will go because they feel that that is their home.
And I will jump on top of my wall that I have been hearing about Israel. Here I am. Ooh, it's like heaven. From synagogue to synagogue, from your home to synagogue, you make your prayers, you get closer to the mighty one, you study. Yeah, it's like heaven. Where I go, I see my brothers and sisters. Oh, shit. I'll be so happy.
Visit Israel someday.
Look at this guy.
The Igbo enthusiasm for Israel has so far not resulted in any return acknowledgement. The only known statement by the Jewish nation was in 1993, when an Igbo man in Israel petitioned the court for citizenship based upon the Igbo-Jewish connection. The Israeli High Court rejected the appeal, firmly dismissing any such relationship. The country's response may be due to the large number of Ethiopians they are still adapting into Israeli society. Making matters worse, race riots erupted in 2012 over Sudanese refugees, with reports of Israelis attacking Africans and demanding their return home. One Israeli minister gained headlines when she referred to the refugees as a cancer. The Prime Minister's solution was to offer each African $1,000 to return to the lands where they had fled persecution. With numerous pockets of Jews arising in other African nations, Israel remains in a state of fear, and the Igbo on their own. But a glimmer of hope blossomed on a March morning a few years ago, when Nigerians across the country awoke to the following headline in the Nigeria Daily Sun.
The ambassador of Israel in Nigeria is affirming that he is sure that Igbos are descendants of the Jews.
Yes.
Everybody celebrated it. You should know, Jews all over the world, I'm happy to identify with Eretz Israel.
Yes.
The warm embrace of Ambassador Katz was perhaps a sign of good things to come. For a few years later, the Jews of Nigeria received news of a visitor they never imagined possible.
The happiest moment I have in Judaism was the day Hashem answered my prayer and sent a rabbi to me.
Rabbi Howard Gorin from Washington.
When I heard about the coming of Rabbi Gorin, I said, okay, Rabbi is coming. I said, okay, I will wait until I see.
He is going to bring a conservative rabbi who is very, very helpful, that it will benefit all of us. Will I be alive to see somebody called a rabbi? Everybody was ready to contribute so that we will know who is called a rabbi.
Getting off the plane the first time I arrived, then getting to my destination, and people singing and dancing in a circle, singing Hebrew songs of their own creation, it brought me to tears.
Immediately I heard that the rabbi was here, I have to come and see him.
Rabbi Gorin have come to strengthen us, to strengthen our faith.
When Rabbi Gorin visit us, that particular moment, it's just like the whole joy of the world was in my heart.
Everybody was happy to receive Gorin.
Everybody, Rabbi Howard Gorin, Rabbi Howard Gorin, Rabbi Howard Gorin.
Rabbi Howard Gorin, Howard Gorin, Rabbi Howard Gorin, Rabbi.
One person. It could be a 16-year-old boy in yeshiva. It could be a 22-year-old girl in college. It could be a man in his 60s or 70s who is retired but knows the customs, knows Hebrew. And people will say, what are you doing with your time? I see you on the computer every week at the same time. I said, I'm communicating with Pinchas, with Shmuel, with Moshe. Who are these people? They are Jews of Nigeria. Ah, there are no Jews in Nigeria. And I say, you have to visit yourself and you will not believe what I've seen over and over and over again.
It was that time that I know that the Almighty Father has answered my prayer. Hashem, bring this man down to my synagogue. Where am I? There are so many rich men that can handle him and put him in a duplex, in the highest hotel. But Hashem sent him to me.
Love Adonai your Elohim with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And these words which I command you this day you shall take to heart.
He teaches Torah encourages us during our worship and then tries to encourage us in other aspects of life. He knows that we have faced racist abuses from outside, so he wants to make us feel that it's not everybody outside that really thinks of us that
someone
way.
Someone will teach me, but next time I come, someone will teach me.
You see that picture in my house? That picture in my house was the first time that the guru came and dressed him in native attire.
So that is a train. What a privilege it is for me to bring it to a Ebonyi State.
Going to a town called Abakaliki, the capital of Ebonyi State, and addressing the people, teaching them Torah, having that teaching translated from English into Igbo, and to see the response of the crowd and their hunger for traditional Jewish learning, then taking out a Torah scroll and unwrapping it, and have them walk inside and see a Torah for the first time,
is the song that the Israelites sang when they crossed the Red Sea.
And see the joy that it brought them. You know, I wasn't feeling well that day. I was not eating well. It was very, very hot. And yet, I know.
Here and here are the Ten Commandments.
I knew that this brought them immeasurable joy.
We have learned so much from him, and he's a strong man moving from one place to another. We went to Kaduna, visited Christians, Muslims, interfaith, and the governor, trying to create awareness that there are Jews in Nigeria. We visited some politicians too at Abuja. So there's been an awareness going around that a Jewish rabbi is in Nigeria, and can you believe it, that there are Nigerian Jews?
That we can look up to, that we have our rabbi is in America.
Personally, he's like a father to me. I've seen so much love in him. He radiates love to us. He's a man with a large heart.
This is Fox 5 News at 10.
From the heart of a Rockville rabbi and his congregation, a huge gift is headed to Africa. Rabbi Howard Gorin and Tikvat Israel filled a 40-foot trailer to send to Jewish communities in Nigeria.
What I noticed, on the one hand, great passion for Judaism, great commitment, great willingness to sacrifice. What I didn't see was any logistical support, no schools, and no books. I saw two or three sidurim, a lot of photocopies of sidurim. I knew that I was going to come back. I knew that my work there was not over.
We are going to be setting up 10 libraries in Nigeria, and this is something that has never happened before. Our coordinator here, Elam, did the connection with Imo State University. Starting a library there is going to encourage people to learn about the Jewish people, learn about the Jewish religion and their customs. Even if it doesn't encourage them to practice Judaism, it's going to make them have a better knowledge about the Jewish people. When the books arrive, I'll be the one to distribute the books and then see that those books are safe. There are selfish people among us who wouldn't want these books to go to certain places. They would want the book to come to their own synagogue or their own community and things like that. And now I'm going to be facing a lot of troubles about it. We had barely gotten a handful of books, and then when these books come, some of the leaders would hijack the books, throw it under their bed, and people wouldn't get to read them. I've had some accusations already that I'm being enticed by some people, and that is why I went to cite the library into the place, which are false. You know, so I know I'm going to be encountering a lot of problems, but I'm not perturbed because I know it's my duty. Whatever comes, I'll face it.
The books are being distributed among Shema Yisrael communities, an umbrella organization created to unite individual synagogues into a national organization. Its biggest challenge to date is democracy.
We've always talked about a democratic system where everybody would have a say in the running of the community, and then we have the right to choose who leads us. We don't want self-made leaders that would never want to step aside if it's not doing well, because that is the only way we can move forward.
Democracy is still a goal not yet achieved. Shema Israel has had several elections, but not with any real democratic results. As for the container holding 8,000 pounds of books from Rabbi Gorin's community, its future looked a bit dubious as it sat in port in Lagos for over 4 months, but eventually the community organized its collection. Its fair distribution is still debated.
After Rabbi Gorin's visit, the way he accepted me and other brethren, I was encouraged. I was encouraged so much. My interaction with him really made me to believe that I need to study. I need to improve my Jewishness. I want to go to rabbinical school. I want to come out as a rabbi and then come back home to work for my people. I want to go to JTS, Jewish Theological Seminary, in New York. I first saw the school in the internet in 2003. I actually wanted to apply. I didn't even know I needed recommendations and other things. But I said, let me fill the form and apply. But when I got to the fees, I now knew that it was a tall dream for me. The Rabbi Gorin came and I told him about the school. So he told me that was the school he attended to become a rabbi. And he has been encouraging me to keep the dream alive. And he has told me that is his goal, not a promise, a goal that he wants to achieve.
Shmuel is one of the finest young men I've ever met. Amazing young man. What he's learned about Judaism is mostly self-taught, but it's very, very accurate. What impresses me is Shmuel knows so much about the outside Jewish world. And he told me he'd love to go to the Jewish Theological Seminary. The hard part is not the expense. The hard part is getting him a student visa to come to the United States.
If I make it to the school, I may be the only black student there. I know I'm going to meet some nice people who would accept me, but still I know some people there would look at me as, who is this? Who's this black man who wants to become a rabbi? And I know I'm going to face something like that. It's going to be strange in the beginning. I've heard of New York being a place where people are free to do whatever they like. I've heard of people carrying guns, shooting in the streets and things like that. I'm going to confine myself to the Jewish community. I wouldn't be going out too far, so it doesn't really scare me. Even in Africa here in Nigeria, sometimes you find yourself in environments that are not friendly because you want something. If you put all those things into consideration, you may never get there. So sometimes we ignore the obstacles and then move on. I'll try as much as possible to remain focused because I know being a rabbi is going to help me to coordinate Nigerian Jews.
Shmuel is a good brother. We love him. We love him so much. He has really opened our eyes so much.
We hold him very fast. The whole community is our baby.
Let him travel and then go and study. Study and come back and teach us. Study and come back and better off the life of people too.
Even as I'm sitting here, I wish I've already had the knowledge to begin to put things together. So I can't wait to go and come back.
Shmuel recently received good news, an invitation to study at a religious academy in Jerusalem. But ultimately, Israel denied his student visa, and he still waits for the chance to continue his Jewish education. For now, with the resources, aid, and knowledge they have available, the Jewish communities of Nigeria continue forward. For they know this is only the beginning.
In a nutshell, I love being a Jew because it has made me a very bold lady. There is nothing like hypocrisy in me. And not only that, finding myself among this community, I find out that the people in this my community have the same character with me. And I enjoy them. There is our love, togetherness, you know, practicing what is called Judaism. So I'm very happy.
I'm very happy because I see my dreams coming to pass. Not just my personal dreams, but the dream I've always had about Nigerian Jews. It's coming to reality. I see the future of Nigerian Judaism being bright.
When I
look at my hands, my fingers, they are not equal. If God wanted these fingers to be equal, he would have made them equal. There is a reason why he made us different. And nobody can tell me the reason for those yet. And as long as I cannot make these fingers equal, I'm going to accept everybody for who they are and just live my life in helping humanity. It's not about tolerance now, it's about accepting and celebrating our diversities.
Melega hulam, melega hulam.